This is my Keen Observer Rifle Deadeye build, and to me, this is the best Deadeye build for all game modes. Now, when I say all game modes and best, there are some things that you have to consider, right? Because each game mode is going to have an optimal meta build. But if you're going to constrain yourself to just playing one build, I find that this build gives you the best results if you change only a few things and just maintain that same idea throughout each game mode. And you might not have the ability to change your build, say like if you want to play Berserker in PvE and you want to play Trailblazer in World versus World, well then you have to have two different weapon sets. So the idea of this build is to maintain one set of armor and only change the traits when you want to adapt to the game mode or the situation. Also, you have some role players out there who like to just play one build because that is what their character's identity is, and I can see that too. So let's get into the build. First of all, let's go over the core mechanics of Deadeye so that you can understand how the traits will be important. So as a Deadeye, your steel ability becomes Mark. When you mark a target, you will deal more damage to them and take less damage from them, but you will also gain malice. So I'm going to mark the target here, and that'll give me one malice. One malice is obtained because of this trait, Malicious Intent. But whenever I hit the target with an ability, so one of my 1 through 5 skills, it needs to cost initiative, it will give me more malice. So if I critically hit with one of my initiative skills, it has to do damage, it will give me 2 malice. If I only hit the target and it doesn't crit, it will only give 1. This build has a lot of crit chance, so oftentimes you will be getting 2 malice every time you hit with a skill that uses initiative. So as you gain malice, you are only buffing up the ability of your sneak attack. So whenever you're in stealth, you gain a new 1 ability. It's Death Judgment on your rifle, and Death Judgment is just a hard-hitting ability that will scale up the more malice you have. So it originally does like this much damage, 3000, but for each malice you have, you will do 10% more damage on your Death Judgment. So that's going to increase the damage of your Death Judgment by 70% if I have maximum malice. The only other reason you really want to have malice is for Maleficent 7, because whenever you get to 7 malice, which means you have to hit your target with basically 3 attacks that crit, because you'll gain 1 malice from marking the target, and then you'll gain 2 malice every time you crit, so that's 3 hits, 2, 6, and you'll get 7 initiative whenever you get to maximum malice, and then you'll gain tons of boons for yourself, which will increase your sustain and your damage quite a bit. And then, once you hit with your malice ability, Death's Judgment, you will lose all malice stacks. So often the rotation, depending on the game mode, is because your rifle attacks are mainly going to be your 2 and your 3 skill. Your 1 skill does not cost initiative, so it will not give you malice. So in World versus World and PvP, you'll want to use Skirmisher Shot as a malice builder because it is the most effective, because it costs only 3 initiative and it does a decent amount of damage and it pierces. In PvE, you'll want to use Double Tap because it'll do more damage and it's not as nerfed, so it costs less initiative there. So in PvE, use your 3 skill as a malice builder. In PvP and World versus World, use 2. But you can still use Double Tap in PvP and World versus World if you're looking for that extra burst of damage up front. So you're going to immediately mark your target usually, and since I'm in World versus World, I'm going to spam my 2 skill. And that hit 3 times, all of them crit, and now I'm at full malice. So Now I've gained all my initiative back and a ton of boons. Now I want to land a Death's Judgment to start rolling my malice again, because you can't gain more malice and gain those boons again if you're already at maximum. So there are three ways to go into stealth and use Death's Judgment, which is going to get rid of your malice. You have your stolen ability. So when you land your steal on the target, you'll gain a stolen ability. When you have five or more malice, using that will put you in stealth. You also have your dodge roll. So every time you dodge, you will gain stealth with silent scope, unless you're revealed. You need to be in your rifle to gain that stealth, so you can't do that while in your sword. And you'll also have the ability to use combo finishers. So if you kneel, which is your 5 skill, and then you press your 4 skill, that is a smoke field. And then your 4 skill, while not kneeling, is a leap finisher. So that'll give you stealth. Now it is quite costly to do those together, but if you have more initiative than you have dodge rolls, then it's worth it to do that. So you mark 2, 2, 2, F2, 1. And you'll do a lot of damage with that, and you'll immediately remove all of your malice. Now obviously your target is not going to be standing still and letting you just do that to them if you're in PvP or world versus world. So sometimes you have to time it better, or you have to permutate it a little bit differently, but that is the basic combo right there. You F1, 2, 2, 2, F2, 1. And then you can do it all over again. So if I don't kill the target from that and I land my Death's Judgment, now I can just press 2 again and then get maximum malice. But then you'll have to use your dodge roll, or you'll have to use a finisher to get stealth, because you won't have your stolen ability anymore. And if you miss steal, you won't get a stolen ability. So you'll need to make up for that in other ways. So that is the basic combo that you'll be using, and you can also do it while kneeling, so your 2 skill becomes an immobilize. But it is really good because not only does it give you an immobilize, which means that the target can't move and it will ensure that your abilities land because they can't dodge, but it'll also give you fury and vigor, which means more dodges. So if you're having trouble getting rid of your malice because the target is dodging your Death's Judgment or you can't land it, and you need more ways to get into stealth, you can get a little bit more dodges from gaining vigor from the 2 skill while you're in kneel. So that's pretty good, but mostly you don't want to be using that too much because it's very low in impact other than just locking one target down. Unless you're in like a 1v1 situation, you're going to be an easy target if you're just sitting there kneeling and immobilizing one guy and everyone else can shoot you. Now, in PvP and World v World, your 3 skill actually does become pretty useful while kneeling because it gives you 3 shots instead of 2, so it's 1/3 more damage, and it'll also give you more might. So it is quite more bursty, but usually you do want to just spam skirmisher shot anyways, because it's just quicker and more reliable and it'll give you swiftness. It'll also cripple the target, so it helps you to stick to the target. So that is pretty much the basics of the Deadeye build. Now I'm going to go over the traits and I'm going to talk about some of the traits that you can change around. But for the most part, you are keeping all of these Deadeye traits like this. So you have Maleficent 7, Silent Scope, and Malicious Intent. Then you're going to be using Critical Strikes. Critical Strikes is the bread and butter of any PvE build because it gives you insane damage, and you also have the option to give yourself a lot of sustain. So you're gaining 10% crit chance when you're above 90% HP, which you can very often get. You will also have Signets of Power, which will reduce the cooldown of your Signet skills, which you're using Infiltrator Signet and Signet of Agility. You can trade this out for Twin Fangs if you're in like a raid, or you can take Assassin's Fury if you're in a solo situation in PvE where you're not using signets. You have practice tolerance. This is going to be a trait that you take every single build. It gives you a ton of crit damage based on your precision. And then you have ferocious strikes, which will give you a little bit more damage to targets above 50% HP. And then you have a choice between no quarter and invigorating precision. So no quarter will basically give you, whenever you have fury, 300 ferocity, which is basically 20% more crit damage. And you're critting basically always. So you have 20% more damage, or you can take invigorating precision, which will give you lifesteal on your critical hits, and that will give you more scaling when you have fury, which you pretty much have all the time. So you can get 20% of your critical damage, which you're pretty much doing all the time. So it's 20% of your damage goes into healing, or 20% more damage. So mostly I like to take no quarter in situations in PvE where I have support from my allies, or the mobs are just going to die so quickly that you don't really need to worry about taking pressure from them anyways. Or in world versus world, when you're looking to plus one fights and you have like a team kind of situation. So basically invigorating precision I like to use when I'm by myself to ensure that I have enough sustain. And in PvP, it's also good to use it in situations where you want to be more scrappy and not play the role of like a plus one, but you want to take even fights because you can 1v1 with this build. So yeah, you either want no quarter or invigorating precision depending on the situation. And then you have trickery. Trickery is really good because it gives you a lot of initiative gain, and initiative not only allows you more versatility because you have more options to use your weapon skills, but it'll also give you more opportunities to get your malice to full, which will give you more initiative back. So it's sort of like this feedback loop. The more initiative you have, the more initiative you can get back. So really good synergy there. And just in general, trickery is pretty much mandatory on any PvP thief build. And in PvE, it's not really used that much, but it still gives you pretty good damage modifiers. So I still use it there. And it's just more fun to use trickery because you just have more playability. So you're going to get Kleptomaniac, which whenever you land your steal, you'll gain 2 initiative. You have Thrill of the Crime, which gives you and your nearby allies boons. And this is pretty good because it front loads your fury uptime and gives a little bit of swiftness and might, which can be nice. You can also take Lesser Haste, which is pretty good if you're running a different variant of this build, because it gives you quickness, and you don't really need might and fury because you have plenty of that already. So you can go for Lesser Haste, or you can go for Thrill of the Crime. I just like Thrill of the Crime because it's more reliable. You can't really know when the proc is going to happen from Lesser Haste. And there's a choice between Bountiful Theft, which steals 2 boons and will give them to nearby allies whenever you mark the target, which is a very powerful ability because it prioritizes stability and Aegis and then protection. So if they have stability and Aegis and protection, it won't steal protection, but if they don't have one of the first two, then it will steal protection. And those are the 3 most defensive boons. So it's really good in PvP and worldly world for killing tankier classes. So usually you do want to have Bountiful Theft, but in some cases I do take Trickster because you can run a lot of tricks in this build as well. And trick utilities will cleanse a condition when you have Trickster, and it will reduce their cooldown by 20%. So I'm already using 2 tricks in this build, and you can use Roll for Initiative, and you can use Haste as well. And then you'd want to swap out Signets of Power for either Assassin's Fury or Twin Fangs if you go for this route, and you have like another kind of playstyle. So you get your condition cleanse in this build either from Trickster and Tricks, or you get it from Signets of Power and Signet of Agility. So those are the 2 main options in playstyles for this build. And then you also have like the decision between no quarter and invigorating precision. So those are the main choices kind of laid out for you there. And then finally, you have lead attacks and sleight of hand, which are going to reduce the cooldown of your mark ability. And it's just going to allow you to swap targets more effectively, because if you target something and then you can gain malice on that target, that's good. But if you want to swap targets and your mark isn't off cooldown, well, then you can't gain malice on that next target yet. My other weapon set that I use is the sword pistol, because the sword gives you the most utility for a melee weapon, because you can port to a target and then you can port back to your original location, which gives you a lot of back and forth motion in PvP, which is really good. And also you can port up and down ledges, which is very useful for chasing targets who are on different levels than you. And the sword is also very good because it has AoE damage, whereas if you're using like a dagger melee weapon, you will have a rifle, which is single target, and then you'll have a dagger, which is also very single target. So sword is really good at cleaving down AoE situations in PvE and even world versus world in PvP. You're not always going to be in a 1v1 situation in all game modes. So sword is very good at giving you a little bit more AoE damage when you need it. And then I use the pistol offhand because it gives you CC when you need it. So in PvE, your headshot skill actually is a 2-second daze, which is pretty decent versus break bars. But also your pistol whip is going to do break bar damage as well. So you have a lot of CC for your team in PvE when needed, and AoE cleave, and then you can interrupt key skills in PvP, like people trying to go for reses or just trying to prevent people from counter pressuring you, while also being able to gain your malice because your headshot can still crit. So then for your utility skills, I take withdraw in all game modes because the extra dodge is very useful. You can take hide in shadows if you really want another way to get into stealth and to remove your malice, but generally I feel that this doesn't give you too much value in world versus world in PvP. So if you really want to, you can take hide in shadows in PvE, but it's really not needed there either because you're gonna have plenty of resources there. So I generally take withdrawal in all game modes. Then you'll have Shadow Step. Shadow Step never leaves my bar. It is probably the most powerful and the most fun skill for any thief build. So I would have it even in PvE where it's maybe not necessary all the time, because you can still use it to do mechanics. Say for example, you're doing a raid boss and you need to remove some kind of debuff from you by going to a certain area. Well, then you can go there immediately with Shadow Step, and then you can port back in 15 seconds to the original location. So it allows you to keep uptime on the boss in that situation. And while maybe having more DPS from another skill would end up being better results in the end, this is just going to be safer and sort of do the same thing in a way. So I just like to run Shadow Step, but if you wanted more damage from, say, like Shadow Flare, or you wanted more utility for your team like Shadow Refuge, that could be possible. But I never remove Shadow Step from my bar. The signets that I use are Signet of Agility and Infiltrator Signet, and these both give a passive and an active effect. In World versus World and PvP, I'll use Infiltrator, but in PvE, I would use Assassin Signet. And Assassin Signet just basically gives you damage, so you just want to use that off cooldown. And in PvP and World versus World, I take an Infiltrator Signet because this allows you to make plays, and it will port you to the target and stun break you. And it's very versatile because you can use it defensively and offensively. So you can do stuff like Death Judgment, and then it's a no animation skill, so you can use it in the middle of one of your abilities and that means you can make plays where a skill might be hard to land, but now it's easy to land because you combo it with Infiltrator Signet. So it's very good for PvP combat. And then Signet of Agility will give you 3 condition cleanse and an extra dodge, which is very good aggressive and defensive potential, because you can sometimes remove conditions that slow you down and allow the enemy to survive longer, like weakness and cripple. So Signet of Agility is probably one of the best skills for thieves, next to Shadow Step, and having lowered cooldown on it because of Signets of Power is very good. Now, finally, you're gonna have your elite skill, Daggerstorm. I take in PvP and World v. World because it gives you a very good reflect and evade, which helps you to survive and do damage in AoE situations while being very safe. And in PvE, I will change that to Basilisk Venom. And Basilisk Venom will share a buff to all nearby allies, up to 5 targets, and their next attack will basically stun the target. So that does a lot of CC to break bars in PvE, so you're definitely going to want to be taking that. The armor stats that I take is full Marauders with pack runes, and then I take Valkyrie Backpiece, Valkyrie Amulet, Valkyrie Ring, Berserker Ring, and then 2 Marauder accessories. Then I take a Marauder sword and pistol, and then I take a Berserker rifle. And the reason why the weapons are different stats is because of the Deadeye trait that gives you more precision while in the rifle. So you don't need as much precision while you're in the rifle. So the reason why I have pack runes is because that gives you a lot of your precision, and you basically want to be crit capped on this build because of all of the crit synergies that exist. So how you get it is mostly from pack runes, and you also have a decent amount of health while still getting crit capped, so you can do a lot of damage but also not instantly die if anything touches you. I get to 70% crit chance, and that's why I take this kind of setup, is to get crit capped while I have Signet of Agility up. So if I use Signet of Agility, I lose precision. So when I have Fury, I have 90% crit chance. And then when I am above 90% HP, Keen Observer gives me another 10% crit chance. So I'm at 100% crit chance when I don't use my Signet of Agility and when I'm above 90% HP, which is more likely in PvE. And that's really the only game mode that you really need 100% crit chance in anyways. So in PvP and World v. World, I didn't optimize to get 100% crit chance there, because you don't really need it there. And the sigils that I take are Rage and Celerity on my sword pistol, because this gives 5 and this gives 3 seconds of quickness. So if you disable and crit a foe, then you will have enough quickness to basically have quickness the entire time you are in your sword pistol set before your weapon swap comes off cooldown, because weapon swap is a 9-second cooldown. So you can basically be doing tons of damage and very quick pistol whips and stuff like that, and then you can transition back into your rifle and start doing your Maleficent 7 combos again. On my rifle, I take Force and Air because this is your main DPS weapon, and these are the 2 most reliable damaging sigils that you can get. Let's talk about PvE uses of this build. So if you're in a raid or a fractal, you'll be taking up a DPS slot, which means you want to do as much damage as you possibly can. So you'll be taking the No Quarter trait and the Assassin Signet, and your rotation is going to look very similar. All you do is kneel and then use your mark on the boss. If it's an AoE kind of situation, you want to use piercing abilities rather than the 3 skill, but generally you just spam the 3 skill, and Once you get to full malice, you will reset your malice by using either a dodge roll or a stolen ability into Death's Judgment. The priority on which one you use is you want to always dodge first to remove your malice, and then use your stolen ability when you have no dodges left, because you only have one stolen ability per steal. So you want to pace that out and use your dodges first. And what's really nice about this build is that all of your damage can be done from range, even though most of the time your party is going to want you to be in melee range. You can still be safe if the situation calls for it, and you have a decent amount of health, so if your party isn't really amazing, you can still somewhat survive and still do your job. But a raid boss is not going to just sit there and let you pummel them down. You're going to have to do some mechanics, so you can't just sit there and kneel the whole time. So oftentimes what you'll be doing is going in and out of your kneel, but either way, you're just going to be pressing the 3 skill because it is the best DPS in the kneel or in the standing state. And in open world PvE content, you can solo pretty much 99% of the game as this build. So the reason for that is because you can swap on the invigorating precision trait and basically become a tank, because the more damage you deal, the more healing you do. So you can be like this heavy hitter that the more damage you do, the more you heal. So you play this very aggressive build and you kind of like shrug off all damage that you take because you heal an absolute ton. And I can also solo fractals with this build, as I've done the 98 fractal in challenge mode's first boss, Mama, with this build. So yeah, it's pretty strong. You can pretty much do all open world content with this build, all story content build, and you will destroy it with this build. You can also use the trickery trait Trickster, which allows you to use haste and roll for initiative instead of signets, and that's very strong for open world because it gives you 3 stun breaks and a lot of quickness, which can be a lot of fun. And depending on the situation you're in, you can change the Deadeye Grandmaster to Be Quick or Be Killed, which is better for chain killing small mobs, whereas Maleficent 7 is better for killing mobs that have a lot of health and might require multiple hits. Be Quick or Be Killed is about chaining those kills quickly and having like permanent quickness if you're constantly tabbing through mobs. Your PvP gear is independent from your actual gear that you're wearing. You can access your PvP stats by clicking this icon, and then you'll have access to an amulet. I run the Marauder amulet with the Scholar rune because pack is not available in PvP. And then on my sword pistol, I take absorption and savagery because savagery will increase the duration of your pistol whip stun. And absorption is nice because you can steal some boons when you're interrupting people. And then on my rifle, I take opportunity and separation because that just gives you the most damage. So the build in PvP is going to be pretty much I take no quarter or invigorating precision. I kind of like invigorating precision nowadays because the meta is so tanky, you're gonna need the sustain to survive those long fights. But if it were a more burst oriented meta, I would like no quarter better. So in PvP, Deadeye is maybe not the best build for the role of thief, which is usually done by a dagger pistol daredevil or a sword dagger daredevil, but Deadeye can still be very useful in some situations, like in a meta that revolves around really tanky classes, because Deadeye doesn't get punished as hard by tanky classes and it can do the DPS required to get the kill, whereas a daredevil might be a little bit more survivable and a little bit more mobile, but it's going to be lacking in damage sometimes. And the good thing about Deadeye is that a lot of your damage, as I said, is very long range. So unlike what I'm doing right now, you don't actually have to go into the middle of these team fights and get ping-ponged around by CCs and AoEs. You can actually play safe and do your damage from afar. So I finally figure that out and I start pressuring the enemy Hollowsmith here, but the enemy Thief, which is a Shadow Arts Daredevil, jumps on me. And this is one of the main reasons why people don't play Deadeye, because if you just play a Daredevil, you counter the Deadeyes, right? But you'll see in this match how I handle rotating and fighting an enemy Thief, and how I use the sword and ports to basically kite. So we start getting kills at mid here, and at this point the Hollowsmith and the Thief are on me, so I have to be very careful and use my ports. I keep target on the Hollowsmith here and sword port in, so that allows me to get away from the Thief. So always remember that ports can be used aggressively and defensively, because you can use them to go towards someone and away from someone. Now the Thief is still chasing me off of the node for no objective, so all I'm trying to do is just survive. And I know that when I get blinded, that means that they're porting to me, so I just precast my sword too, and then as soon as I get blinded, I'm going to return, and that removes the blind and prevents me from getting hit. So yeah, precasting your sword port and being able to return is very good. And I interrupt their stealth here, which helps me to reveal them, and I'm actually doing pretty good in this 1v1 now because of this, even though I had just peeled out of a fight at like 2 HP. So we're doing fine here, and I'm just waiting for my shadow return there. I take the port back, and I try to stand on the node a little bit because I know that he has more stealth than me, and if they have more stealth than me, then I have the advantage in standing on the node because I can draw them out of stealth unless they don't want to contest the node. Now I see that the enemy Hollow is here, and I don't really want to fight that when I've got no cooldowns from fighting their Thief. So I rotate into mid and see if I can get some kills with my team. I see that their Thief is rotating into mid to chase me still, so I'm being careful. I port to the Hollowsmith, but I see that their Necromancer are here as well. So I just go behind the waterfall a little bit just to be safe and make sure that no one else is going to interrupt my 1v1 with the Necro. And Necros are actual food for Deadeyes because they are just HP sponges. And one of the things that Thieves have trouble with when dealing with Necromancers is the sheer amount of damage you need to kill them. Well, Deadeyes don't really have that problem, so they can do the necessary damage required to get the kill here. And the Necro Lich forms me, and they're actually doing a pretty good job of kiting me behind this pillar here and surviving, even though I do think I have the advantage in this 1v1. So I'm just waiting for them to leave Shroud so that I can do damage to them. I actually miss my pistol whip twice there, so that's gonna be a very bad loss, I think. I'm pretty much losing this 1v1 right now. And then the enemy Thief jumps on me, so I think I might have lost that anyways, but I got plus 1'd anyways. You have to be careful with this build because even though you can 1v1, you're not one of those defensive 1v1ers where you can survive being outnumbered for long. How you survive being outnumbered is you rotate and go somewhere else. So you gotta be careful with that. But I am going to respawn, and remember, don't die, always survive, because if you're dead, then what happens to my team right now will happen to your team. We're all getting snowballed on the map, and that means that I can't really go into the rest of the map because they're all dying anyways. I'm just going to go into a losing fight if I do it. So what I do here is I put my sword 2 down preemptively, so as soon as I get the decap, I can take it back and then engage on this dragon hunter. I bait out 2 dodges, and then they use their heal skill. So I know that they basically have nothing after this shield ends, and then I aggressively shadow step to land my death's judgment, and that allows me to get the kill very quickly, which is really nice because that dragon hunter build, yeah, it's sort of like a meme kind of like trap build, but it is very aggressive and can get kills on my team. So the ability for me to hunt down enemy carry builds, and even if they're like kind of meme builds, I just eliminate them, and it kind of peels for my team in a way because they don't have to deal with that. So it is kind of a anti-carry role to play Deadeye, so it's kind of nice. And then I decide that I don't want to stay far and watch that respawn because my team probably needs me in the fight. So instead, I chase kills with my team. Now I see that the enemy necromancer is on top of the wall here, so I try to interrupt them as much as possible with pistol whip, and I headshot their heal. That's why I really love the offhand pistol there, and I interrupt their heal again with the stolen ability to give me stealth into a tactical strike, which is a daze when hitting from behind. And then another thing that's really nice is I get the stomp there without getting feared because I have blinding powder. So the pistol offhand I really like, and it allows you to have a lot of utility. So I get the kill there now that we're counter snowballing the map, and I go into far. I leave down my sword to port before I go onto the node so I can rotate faster. And I'm gonna go for the full cap here because I do want to take some 1v1s. So I take the sword port back as I see that the Necro is gonna lich me again. So this is the second time the Necro's liching me. And I line of sight until I realize that they're going for the node, and then I go back and try to counter pressure them. The Necro took a lot of their health here, and I used my infiltrator signet aggressively to try to get the kill quickly. And then I go for the stomp, but the enemy thief plus ones me again. So you gotta be careful here, but this time I'm a little bit more healthy because I was winning the 1v1. So I play very greedy and play for the cleave. And this is what's good about invigorating precision here, is that I can stay in these situations and survive by just hitting the downstate body and cleaving it. So I'm just kiting around using my sword too very intelligently here to kite the thief while also keeping the necromancer in downstate. And now I'm pretty healthy, but I need to keep the downstate as long as possible until my steel comes up where I can interrupt the thief. And unfortunately, the necromancer gets res just as my steel comes up. But my support warrior comes in and saves me, so this is pretty nice. But at this point, I do want to leave because the thief is just going to tunnel vision me, as they have pretty much all game. And I leave far, but then I see that my team is kind of outnumbering the rest of the map, so I come back in to help my teammate here. I think they're playing a Condi Rev build. But yeah, now the thief is just going to chase me off node. I get a very unlucky non-crit death judgment there. I would have gotten the kill on the thief here, but they run back into base, I believe, here. So we've scared off the enemy thief, and that allows us to plus one this necromancer with my revenant. So we get that kill, and I'm just going to cleave it out and get my Maleficent 7 to kind of give me more sustain. And you'll notice here, I'm also using the Shadow Meld Elite instead of Dagger Storm. You can do either one, but I knew that since the enemy had a thief, I'd want a little bit more stealth to be able to be more deceptive. And at this point, we have a triple cap because we've snowballed the map, and now this is pretty much going to be a victory. So yeah, that's pretty much how you want to play the Deadeye build. You can 1v1 a little bit, but you have to be careful, and otherwise you want to be getting kills and snowballing the map, or essentially getting momentum for your team. One thing that you do want to get used to is running around the map with your sword 2 and your rifle 4, because Those allow you to decap nodes, as I was showing with the sword 2, and then go back in. And your rifle 4, if you use the about face technique, you can use it to get a lot of movement around the map. If you want to know how to use the about face, then you can check out my video, which I'll link below, how to about face. For world versus world, thieves in general don't really fit in large scale combat. They prefer to be in smaller scale roaming situations. And a lot of roamers nowadays are playing the dagger pistol Daredevil, which, as I said earlier in the PvP section, it is your counter. So you are going to have a little bit of trouble in solo roaming, but in group roaming, this build is really good at securing kills in like small scale, maybe like 3 to 5 player combat. And if you really wanted to, you could go into like a 20v20 kind of situation, because you can stay at range with your rifle, and if you do go into melee, you do have evade frames with pistol whip. So the build isn't like amazing at either zerging or at solo roaming, but it fits somewhere in the middle of that. And how you want to play as a Deadeye when you're roaming is you want to abuse terrain, because when you stand on terrain, it allows you to kneel, because you'll get extra range and you don't really want to be moving too much when you're on terrain anyways, so you don't really get the detriment of kneeling as much when you're on like a signpost or some sort of like wall, and that'll give you the advantage of being higher than your opponent. And if they try to jump up to where you are, it's going to be very difficult for them to also avoid your attacks. So in a way, you want to be camping a certain territory as a Deadeye and not so much going into open fields, because then you're a lot more vulnerable, and Deadeye is obviously a more vulnerable thief specialization. But when you do have control of a territory, it is harder for people to aggress you. So like in a defensive situation, like you're defending a tower or a camp, Deadeye can be really good because you have guards and other things like walls and stuff to peel for you and to use as cover. And that pretty much sums up the build. So if you have any questions, leave them in the comments below, or join my Discord to ask me or message me at any time, and like and subscribe if you want more of this kind of content, and check the description. I have some links to my build playlist for World v World and PvP. I've got tons of builds out there. They're not necessarily meta all the time, but they will show you how the classes work, and they probably won't be useful in all game modes like this build, but they're still very useful. And I'll also leave a link in the description of the open world build playlist that Wooden Potatoes has for PvE, because I don't really have a PvE build playlist. But yeah, check that out, and I'll see you next time.